Financial Survival Network, helping you to survive and thrive in the new economy.
This is the Financial Survival Network.
Financial Survival Network is presented to you by Regal Assets. Buy and sell physical gold and silver through your existing retirement plan 100% tax-free with Regal Assets. If you want to include physical gold or silver in your existing IRA or old 401k, request your free investment kit, which was recently featured in the Forbes and Smart Money Wall Street Journal magazines. Call toll-free 855-678-6620, 855-678-6620, or visit regalassets.com.
Carrie Lutz here at the Hard Assets Conference in beautiful renovated Times Square with Eric Sprott, and just got done with a keynote speech. So everybody here, if I could sum up the feeling, the attitude, they're all kind of downed out about prices, and you don't appear to have that problem.
No, I'm down about prices too. I'm just a little upbeat about what should happen, and I grant you that some of the things that we would imagine happening should have already happened. But when I look at the supply-demand data for gold, the supply-demand data for silver, when I see the sort of financial chaos that's going in the world, I have no doubt that gold and silver will be the top-performing assets going forward. When we absolutely hit the bottom, I have no idea. I suspect we're getting close because all the metals and stocks are oversold. I mean, at any moment, something could blow up in the world, as you know, more and more countries have problems. So I'm not, I haven't lost my confidence in the fact that people should be in precious metals, and I think the data supports that more and more every day.
Yeah, the black swans are circling. And if I could use a contrarian indicator, I've been to a number of conferences where you've spoken, and there hasn't been an empty seat in the house. Here, there were a number of empty seats, and to me, that flashed a major buy signal.
Well, a lot of people aren't interested at the bottom, and as I said, the stocks look like they're oversold on a technical basis. Everyone's a little depressed, and we've had a one-year decline in precious metals prices here, the most dramatic being in silver, which is almost down 50% from its high, so I can understand the mood of people being somewhat despondent. But by the same token, that typically is a sign of a bottom, and when it turns around, everyone will be fat and happy again.
Yeah. Well, I guess these cycles, you've seen them come and go, the metals, but what is it about the metals sector from a personal level that got you into it that really brought you down this path?
I don't even know if I want to call it the metals area, because let's call it the precious metals area, because I realized we were going into a bear market in 2000. It would be a sustained bear market. There's only one way to survive a bear market properly, that's to own gold and gold stocks, which has certainly proven to be the case in the last 12 years. Not so in the last year, but certainly for the years before that, it was a great place to be. And you could see a number of factors that were going to change for gold and silver from a physical perspective, where central banks would stop selling and now they're buying, companies would stop hedging and now they have stopped hedging. The ETFs didn't exist, now they exist. So there's lots of positives going on in the gold business silver business that would argue for much higher prices.
Mm-hmm. And in your speech, you were talking about the world, the United States, the Western economies hitting what you kind of referred to as a Minsky moment,
right,
where the debt can't be paid, the promises that were made can't be kept. And how do we do this in a rational way that doesn't cause chaos, where there's a global realization that government, for whatever reason, can't do what it said, from the money system to every other program,
right?
Things have to change. How do we get to that transition point?
There's no rational way in my mind. I think the problem is over-leverage in the banking system, in the financial system. And the only way to cure over-leverage in the financial system is to de-lever. De-lever means less loans. Less loans means less GDP. And I think it's the problems in the banking system that have caused all these problems at the government level. I mean, Greece would not have the problem it has today if their banks didn't need huge injections of money that Greece had to put into it. Same with Spain now, putting money into the banks. And, of course, the more money they put in the banks, the more problem that Spain itself has. I mean, they announced the last bailout of a bank. What happened to their interest rates? They went up 50 basis points in about a week because the government has to solve the banking problem. you can't solve this problem without some kind of delevering. They just got way over-levered, and it's been a system that's evolved for 100 years since 1913 when they started the Fed.
Right.
The banks kept wanting to make more and more money, to leverage more and more. Now all of a sudden we find ourselves too levered and the game's over.
Yeah, the good old days when people used to buy cars and appliances for cash, where a mortgage was not something that you bragged about, your rate and all that stuff. But then we look at Iceland, they had the collapse and they basically said goodbye to the banks. Obviously small economy, but now they're growing again and they're doing it without the benefit of credit. So maybe there's a lesson there.
There is a lesson. I mean, that's the whole lesson of leverage is you have to repudiate your debt, which is the process Greece is going through, and that will continue in many places going forward.
Yeah, one article I had done, I postulated the concept of a bankruptcy court for countries, just like we have for corporations and individuals and even some governments in the U.S. So the country goes there and they go bankrupt, they file, and then the lawyers get rid of all the burdensome agreements and promises, and then they start over again, fresh start. And maybe that's something we need to start thinking about, because there's surely a huge line to the sovereign bankruptcy court.
Totally. There's no question that the governments can't meet their obligations, and that's why we've constantly recommended owning gold and silver.
All right. Hey, Eric, thanks so much for being on the Financial Survival Network. It's been a pleasure.
Kerry. All the best, Kerry. Thanks.
You too.